Good evening. My name is Carol Fountain Nix, and I'm a proud NC State alumnus and the director of the Craft Center. It is an honor to be with you tonight. Some of you are here with us in the magnificent Stewart Theatre, while many more of you are joining us virtually. To provide a little history of this project, it actually began in 2012 as literally the Art of Remembrance, showcasing the stunning World Trade photographs by College of Design graduate Charles Moretz, who you will meet tonight. As time passed, it grew into a way to memorialize the events of 9/11 through more than just the astonishing lens of photography, and to encompass sculpture and poetry, monuments, videography, and storytelling. I discovered others from our NC State family who had direct ties to 9/11, and I knew their stories needed to be told and shared. As 20 years have now passed since that fateful morning, the events of that day must be remembered as a critical part of our nation's history. Many students today have no memory of the horror that gripped this nation, so it is more important than ever to use these moments to foster a more inclusive consciousness. Understanding history has always been critical to ensuring a better future, and education and the arts are central to delivering the message of lessons learned. Art provides the fearless message and inquiry. Receiving the message requires introspection and understanding. Understanding requires responsibility, and responsibility requires action. This is what has culminated in tonight's memorial ceremony, and we are proud to share it with you. I'd like to just take a moment to thank the folks who made this presentation possible. First, to Chancellor Randy Woodson for being an unconditional champion of the arts while vehemently supporting diversity and inclusion on our campus, all through a historically challenging pandemic. To Rich Hawley, the executive director for the arts here at NC State, for his enthusiasm and support for this project. To my staff for all their hard work to keep the Craft Center going strong and continuing to build an amazing creative space for our students and our community. To my colleagues at Arts NC State and DASA, my gratitude for the power and spirit of collaboration. And to Nick Drake and the North Carolina State Veterans and Military Services, I thank each of you for your service and for your honorary presence here tonight. And a huge thank you to each of the presenters and performers. You have all made the time to prepare beautiful testimonies and share your works of art. And I deeply and personally appreciate your dedication and generosity. 9/11 is a date that elicits feelings of hopelessness, devastation, and grief for many, but also gives us the chance to remember the acts of kindness, selflessness, and unity that were so commonplace on that day and the days that followed. Art is a gift that provides us with a way to pay tribute to those who were lost in the attacks while also celebrating the best of what America is and can be. This event delves into the past, not just to remind us of what we've lived through and what we live with, but to sharpen our focus on what lies ahead. Thank you.
Good evening. Thank you, Carol and North Carolina State University, for putting together this important and poignant evening. There are moments which mark your life, moments when you realize something will never be the same, and time is divided into two parts, before this and after this. Author anonymous. 8:46 a.m. on September the 11th, 20 years ago, was certainly one of those moments for me. Even to hear 20 minutes is hard to believe. It feels like yesterday and yet a lifetime ago. I'm grateful to be here tonight to share my story. Over the years since 9/11, I've shared this story with many people, but I always felt there was something missing, something I couldn't accurately convey, something I couldn't completely share. It was more than words, sentences, emotions. That something was the how I experienced the events of that day. And the how, for me, was a heightened sense of sound. I remember walking, running out of the building, and instead of hearing the sirens and the first responders and the chaos and the yelling, I heard papers falling from the sky and pieces of concrete hitting the ground. It was important for me to create something that would more accurately tell my story. You may find that although you are hearing my story, you are also putting together your own visual narrative. Why is that? Some would say it's related to the concept of autobiographical memory. To me, it's a vivid recollection of the events of that day through my auditory experience. As you experience the film, you may find that you're recalling your own acquired information, videos, photos, articles that you may have read, stories that you have heard, all that to create your own mind's eye or sound image, what you see when you hear. I don't consider my story special. My story is similar to that of thousands of people who experienced the attacks as I did. My story is just one thread of a greater narrative and human experience. As you watch tonight, there will be a section in the middle where there are no images, only sound. Don't worry, it's not a technical difficulty. Humbly, I share my story, Sound of September.
Are aware of a state which you call is, or reality, or life, this implies another state called isn't, or illusion, or unreality, or nothingness, or death. There it is. You can't know one without the other. And so as to make life poignant, it's always going to come to an end. That is exactly, don't you see, what makes it lively. Liveliness is change, is motion. So, you see, you're always at the place where you always are. And you think, wowee, a little further on we'll get that. I hope we don't go further down so that we lose what we already have. But that is built into every creature's situation, no matter how high, no matter how low. So, in this sense, all places are the same place. And the only time you ever notice any difference is in the moment of transition. When you go up a bit, you gain. When you go down a bit, you feel disappointed, gloomy, lost. You can go all the way down to death. Somehow, there seems to be a difficulty in getting all the way up. Death seems so final. Nothingness seems so very, very irrevocable and permanent. But then if it is, what about the nothingness that was before you started? On the contrary, it takes nothing to have something. Because you wouldn't know what something was without nothing. You wouldn't be able to see anything unless there were nothing behind your eyes. The most real state is the state of nothing. That's what it's going to all come to.
Show you what's going on around the country, kids. On this Tuesday, the night of the Latin Grammys, it's kind of quiet around the country. We like quiet. It's too quiet. That's a quick look at the national forecast. It's an early one.
Yeah, I'll get it.
Hi, everybody. I'm Hillary Howard. It is beautiful outside. Perfect September day with lots of
sun. Shut up. Sleepyhead, wake up. Wake up. You're gonna be late. Oh, you're not going in the city? Okay. All right. I love you. I gotta catch the ferry, baby. I gotta go. I'll talk to you later. I'll see you when I get home. Okay. I love you. Bye.
You want a full record?
Another plane hit the other train center. Holy shit, they're saying that it's a terrorist attack.
We're sorry. All tickets are busy now.
We need to...
you
Good evening. I'm Randy Woodson, and Susan and I are honored to be with you tonight as we all commemorate the 20th anniversary of 9/11. I want to thank Carol Fountain Nix and the Kraft Center for taking the leadership and the responsibility for compiling this program tonight and working with Arts NC State to make this commemorative event possible. And I'm really grateful for their leadership in doing this. You know, there are so many students now at NC State that either weren't alive yet or certainly were too young to remember. And so it's critically important that we all come together to think about the events of 9/11. 3,000 people lost their lives. This country was changed forever. I remember on 9/11, it was, I was living in Indiana, and I was the dean of the College of Agriculture at Purdue, and it was a glorious fall day. And believe me, in northern Indiana, you take every glorious day you can get. And it was a beautiful day, and I dropped my daughter off at school, and I was running a little late, and I ran into the building, and the staff was around a television. And at that point in the day, the story was that a small plane had flown into the World Trade Center. And it, you know, it was being, it was suggested that it was really a tragic accident. But it was soon realized that that wasn't the case, that our country was under attack. And as a leader of a university, the first thing you think about is your responsibility to all of the students and the faculty, and you try to think about, you know, what's happening. But as a father and a husband, you immediately go to, where's my family? Are they safe? What's going to happen next? And it was just, it was a horrendous day that resonates with all of us that experienced it in different ways. And you see the Trade Center, the first of the two buildings, collapse in literally seconds. And you immediately think of all of those people that were trapped in that building, and not long afterwards, the second Trade Center collapse. So it's critically important that we all reflect on what that day meant to our country. It's changed a lot about the way security is managed in the United States, and it certainly changed a lot about the way we think about our lives and go about our lives. So I thank you all for being here tonight and taking time out of your busy schedule to remember and to commemorate the event 20 years ago, hard to believe, and also to honor all of those people that sacrifice their lives and their health, particularly the first responders that have struggled so much as a result of being exposed to everything associated with those buildings that came down. And of course, the Pentagon, and then those amazing people that took matters into their own hands and brought a plane down that was headed to the U.S. Capitol in Pennsylvania. So heroes, no doubt, across the entire spectrum. So if you will join me in just a brief moment of silence to really remember and to honor all of those that gave their lives for our country on such a horrible day. So join me in silence. Thank you again for being here. This is going to be, and already has been, a very memorable evening. Thank you.
10 years ago, I had an idea for a 9/11 memorial. I named it Genius Loci, that's Latin, for the spirit of the place. It's an uplifting and inspiring design, honoring and celebrating the original World Trade Center, a city within a city, and those that lived and worked there. It is the art of remembrance, shining a light on what should be remembered, honored, and celebrated. The principal feature of the design is my signature collection of photography of the Twin Towers. Today, my film will introduce you to Genius Loci and the history and context of its evolution. I'm honored to participate in this memorial today. I'm lucky to be a native of North Carolina and very fortunate to be a 1972 graduate from the School of Design here. And so, in a way, everything about Genius Loci has its beginnings here. Thank you. I first fell in love with the Twin Towers at night, walking my dog through empty streets into that deserted 5-acre plaza, the gateway to those massive towers. They had a presence, a spirit, monumental structures with magnificent power and strength. They were so New York. My name is Charles Moretz. In 1972, I graduated from the School of Design at North Carolina State. I moved to Manhattan the next day. I'm a visual artist and designer. I live downtown in an area known as Soho. In the early 70s, New York was a much different place than it is now. More diverse, less homogeneous. In a way, it was bigger. There was a place for everybody. Each neighborhood had a distinct character. When you crossed from one block to another, you entered a different world. The city was going bankrupt. There were lots of homeless men sleeping on the streets. There were cheap bars and a lot of trash. People didn't roam around freely then. It wasn't safe. It was intimidating. But there was also a lot of art activity going on. A new and vibrant community of young people springing up downtown. It was exciting. As an artist in residence, I was able to legally live in a warehouse loft. This was so far from my experience in North Carolina. I loved it. And with all this going on, there was the construction of the World Trade Center. Some said the towers had a kind of arrogant beauty, but for me, they were inspirational. They became my muse. The architect Minoru Yamasaki got his inspiration for two towers when he saw this while traveling in San Gimignano, Italy.
In the space represented by this Port of New York Authority model, 300,000 people come to work every day. The authority, no mean planners themselves, have launched a project that will change the entire profile of Lower Manhattan, the World Trade Center. Long in the news, plans for the center have been revised and worked upon since 1962. Surrounding the world's two tallest buildings will be a plaza nearly 5 acres in size. The center will do more than change the skyline. It will bring another 130,000 people into its confines every working day. But the moment they step outside, they will find old New York.
Principal construction took 7 years. It was called the big job. 1 million cubic yards of dirt were removed even before they started building. 200,000 tons of steel went up. 425,000 cubic yards of concrete poured. 3 floors built every 10 days. A daring venture. American might on display. When the Twin Towers were opened, Lower Manhattan was completely transformed. You had restaurants, shops, delis, shoe repair, dry cleaners, apartments. There was nightlife. They even had their own zip code. A sense of order came to downtown. It really did become a city within a city. I had to photograph those buildings. In 1982, I was awarded a commission by Guy Tozzoli, president of the World Trade Centers Association, to create a series of large photographic murals of the Twin Towers for a permanent installation at Windows on the World. It was Guy Tozzoli, a 35-year-old engineer who juggled all the competing interests of the Trade Center project. He was a dynamo. He got the Twin Towers built. I explored the towers for months, from every angle, under different lighting conditions. I captured the final versions with my 8x10 camera. The images have a narrow color palette, silver buildings, black shadows, and that vast blue sky. I wanted the pictures to be simple, bold, and graphic. The Mohawk steelworkers said they were working in air where nobody had been before. I felt pulled up into that sky. Here is the South Tower facade reflected on an adjacent building. This image was taken from the 92-acre landfill that became Battery Park City. That same crystal blue sky that embraced the Twin Towers on the morning of Tuesday, September the 11th, 2001. When the towers came down, I was numb.
I can't believe it. Monday, this was 120 stories. Now look at it.
The fires burned for months. A tangle of death and debris that covered 16 acres. There was a place where the North Tower fell. It seemed to hold the spirits of those who perished. So many lost, so much destroyed, so quickly. Our city, sanctified by fire. That sense of order, gone. I knew I needed to bring back my pictures to honor and remember. My vision is to create a permanent installation to commemorate the spirit of the Twin Towers, that city within a city. Current technology will allow large-scale display of these iconic images set within an expansive yet simple architectural space. This will be a place of peace and contemplation, even celebration, offering the visitor an otherwise unobtainable experience. It's the genius loci, the spirit of the place, the art of remembrance. I don't want the Twin Towers to be just a shadow in the sky.
Thank you. Got my work clothes on, full of sweat and dirt. All this holy dust upon my face and shirt. Heading uptown now, just as the shifts are changing to Grand Central Station. I got my lunchbox, got my hard hat in my hand. I ain't no hero, mister, just a working man. And all these voices keep on asking me to take Grand Central Station. Grand Central Station. I wanna stand beneath the clock just one more time. Wanna wait upon the platform for the Hudson Line. I guess you're never really all alone, or too far from the pull of home, and the stars upon that painted dome still shine. I made my way out on the 42nd Street. I lit a cigarette and stared down at my feet. Imagined all the ones that ever stood here waiting at Grand Central Station. Grand Central Station.
Hi, my name is John Sequeira. I attended NC State University from 1997 to 2001. I graduated in May of that year and moved up to New York City in June for a job on the 81st floor of Tower 1 of the World Trade Center. At around 8:46 that morning, an airliner manned by terrorists slammed into our building intentionally around 10 floors above where I sat, kicking off an hour-long journey down the stairs. Once we were guided to the stairwell, we made our way from floor 81 to 67 in a pretty quick pace. The stairwells were not yet packed with other people, but on the 67th floor, I ran into my boss, Mike, and we compared notes of what we had seen. He had just been in our office and told me that it was devastated and just destroyed, and we were ready to make our way down the stairs because everybody else in our office, according to Mike, was already ahead of us. But before we left, we could hear people in the hallways of the 68th floor, and we decided to go upstairs and let them know that this stairwell was open and that this was a way out. Once we got to the hallway of the 68th floor, we saw that the group we had heard was not the only group there, and so behind that group was another group, and behind that group was yet another, until we happened upon an office, and through glass doors we saw that there were people standing there, seemingly not really doing anything or making any efforts to evacuate. We banged on the windows and the doors to get into that office, and once we did, we yelled at everybody to evacuate and told them what we knew, because maybe we thought everybody wasn't aware of the scale of what was happening. And then we realized that they were standing there, not moving, not because they didn't want to escape, but because one of their office workers was a wheelchair user. And in her motorized wheelchair, the method of getting out of the building wasn't clear. So we offered our help, and we were guided to an emergency wheelchair that was much lighter and easier to maneuver, that had been installed in that office during the bombing that took place in 1993. And so we grabbed the emergency wheelchair, helped our new friend into that, and moved towards the stairwell. Once we arrived in the stairwell, it had become packed with other people who also were trying to evacuate, and found that that was one of the very few ways out. And so moving down the stairs was quite slow going from the 67th floor to probably around the mid-40s when we were met by first responders, firefighters, who were making their way up the building with gear and their suits and just carrying sheer exhaustion and the look of somber fear on their face. We then realized that this was much more serious than even we thought. And at that time, we were offered to take a break and move out of the stairwell onto what seemed like a safer space in the mid-40s of the building, at which point I called my father to tell him where I was, and he, in very short form, just told me to get out as quickly as possible. So we headed back to the stairwell and continued our way down until we happened upon the lower 10 floors, where it was completely dark, and we were walking in knee-deep water from the sprinkler system of 110 stories collecting towards the bottom of the building. We followed firefighters who were helping us out of the building, and realized that the original path that they used to come up the stairs was now blocked, presumably by the debris from the collapse of Tower 2. And so after a few moments of trying to identify what the best path to escape was, we were able to make our way into the lobby. The lobby was completely destroyed, with turnstiles blown off of their bases and impaled in the walls, Florida ceiling, plate glass windows completely destroyed, and a silence of the typical activity that we've seen in the lobby, but coupled with the distant sound of sirens and radios from first responders getting messages from their control centers. We were told to evacuate in any way we could, and so my boss, the woman who we had helped out, and I exited outside through a broken window and made our way to the West Side Highway. Shortly after our exit, Tower 1 of the World Trade Center began to collapse, with us a mere block or two away. And we made our way up the West Side Highway, running, trying to escape the cloud of smoke and debris, taking refuge behind a news van and my boss underneath a fire engine. Once the air dissipated and cleared, we made our way up to the boundary set by first responders and media. That was now the boundary of what was beginning to be called Ground Zero. That day, the events, our involvement in it, shifted my priorities in life to focus on family and friends and acts of service, and ultimately led me to the realization that we are most fulfilled when we serve others.
It matters what voices you listen to. It matters what books you read. It matters what you buy. What you do with your money, if you have it, and how you interact with those who don't have it. It matters who you surround yourself with and why. It matters where you put your life labor. It matters where you put your love labor. It matters where you put your creative labor and what you create and why. It matters what you let into your life and what you are willing to live with. It matters what relationship you have to the planet or you don't. It matters how you respond to danger at the door, even when it's at your neighbor's door. We gather this evening at our neighbor's door. We gather in grace, invitation. We gather in wonderment, we gather in peace, and we gather bringing the medicine. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillah, Rahmanir Rahim. Lifting veils. September 11, 2001. One. It is a blood-stained horizon whispering, La ilaha illallah, prelude to a balmy evening that envelops our embrace. We stand, reaching across sands, waters, airs full of blood. In the flash of a distant storm, I see you standing on another shore, torn hijab, billowing towards an unnamed wind. We both wear veils, blood-stained, tear-stained, enshrouding separate truths. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. 2. Misty morning teardrops of dust choke and stain lips that do not move, will not utter. It is a morning of shores, sea shadows that caress memory of another time, another veil, another woman needing, reaching, lifting. 3. Into your eyes I swam, searching for veils to lift, to wrap, to pierce, dance with. Veils that elude such mornings. Veils that stain such lips. Veils tearing like music. La ilaha illallah. 4. It is the covering of spirit, not the body. My hijab, your hijab. Connecting, interweaving, crawling, snaking, binding into a sky that will not move.